I think students can hear what I'm speaking. I think yes. Can you hear? Are the audio and video perfect? Somebody can reply. Yeah, yes. Okay, so today the topic which I promised will be on approach to anemia. So anemia itself, we are not going to tell the definitions of anemia in the first place, because it's going to be on approach. So you have different definitions for anemia based on the hemoglobin as well as the PCV cutoffs, but what we are trying to see is only on the approach to anemia. So what are going to be the approach? So first, you all know that anemia will be divided into three types, because there are many types of classification are there, but we generally tend to classify the anemia by morphology. Yeah, so we tend to classify the anemia by morphology only. So how we are going to classify anemia by morphology into three types? One, we know it's a microcytic anemia. Second one, obviously, it's a normocytic anemia. Third one, it's a macrocytic anemia. All right. So, but tell me, so what is the definition of microcytic anemia? I mean, what do you mean by objective definition of a microcytic anemia? Anyone? It's based on the MCV only, obviously, because we need to know the MCV, mean corpuscular volume. So based on MCV, when will you call it's a microcytic anemia? It's a very easy question. It's not something very difficult. So it's a very easy one. Yep, when it is less than 80 femtoliters. So whenever it is less than 80, we call it as microcytic. 80 to 100, it is normocytic, which means this is the normal range. Anything more than 100, it will be macrocytic anemia. So less than 80 microcytic, 8 to 100 normocytic, and more than 100 we are going to call it as macrocytic. So based on this only we are going to delineate. So this microcytic anemia can also be told, you know, like by a pathologist. For example, if you have a pathologist, they used to compare with the nucleus of a small lymphocyte. For example, this is a small lymphocyte. So which means by looking at itself, you can tell this is a small lymphocyte. Yeah. If this is the case, the RBC size should be equal to that of a nucleus of a small lymphocyte. This is a nucleus of a small lymphocyte, and normally in the peripheral smear, the RBC size should be equal to that of a nucleus of a small lymphocyte. If it is less than that, it's likely to be a microcytic anemia. If it's more than that, it's likely to be a macrocytic anemia. So, I mean, this is not accurate, but still, just by looking at the peripheral smear, you can tell to an extent. So, whether it's microcytic or a macrocytic or a normocytic, I mean, approximate equivalence. So, the nucleus of a small lymphocyte should be the calibration size when you're grossly looking on the peripheral smear. That should be the size of the RBC, basically. Clear? So, this should be the case. Screen is not visible clearly. I think I can see, and I can see in the YouTube also. I'm looking at the YouTube. I think it's seen clearly only. So is it not seen clearly, whatever I'm writing? Anyone? Actually, I am also looking on the YouTube simultaneously. I think I can make out. So what's happening? So if possible, go to the full screen mode. Suppose if you're not able to see clearly, or if it's smaller in size, you can go to the full screen mode. All right. So microcytic, normocytic, and macrocytic. Alright, so what are the types of microcytic anemia? So you have basically three different types of microcytic anemia. Thank you, Sabri. It's clear only because I can also see. I can also look at it. So three types of microcytic. One is defective heme synthesis. So it could be defective heme synthesis. Or second, it could be defective globin synthesis, because this is the one that's going to contribute to the hemoglobin. And third, unrelated thing. Many people would forget that even in copper deficiency, also, you will get microcytic anemia only, because the mechanisms of how copper deficiency causes microcytic anemia is not really known. but still copper deficiency also produces microcytic anemia. All right. So copper deficiency also is going to cause a microcytic anemia only. Apart from that, whenever you take the basis of a microcytic anemia, so you have hemoglobin production. So where you're going to get, so you have two things. One is heme production. At the same time, you should have globin also. So when both combine together, this is what is going to give hemoglobin. So you know that globin is going to contain two chains. One is it has to come from alpha globin. Second on beta globin. So normal and adult hemoglobin is made of two alpha chains and two beta chains. So that's what is going to form a globin. Obviously, to get a heme, you need a lot of other things. Like you need a good supply of iron. Clear? Iron you need. At the same time, you need a protoporphyrin synthesis also. Proper protoporphyrin synthesis. So then only both are essential for producing heme. So all these things, if they are regulated properly, then only you get the final molecule, that is hemoglobin. So anything that causes reduction in the hemoglobin inside the RBC will usually result in microcytic anemia. Because the hemoglobin is the major constant of the RBC, we all know that. So this is an RBC, and RBC doesn't have any organelle. The major constant of hemoglobin, RBC is the nucleus. Clear? So any time whenever the hemoglobin content is going to reduce, the RBC size is also going to reduce, obviously. So that's what we're going to call it as a microcytic anemia. So Mullai Vendan, I told you why copper deficiency. Copper deficiency, the mechanisms are not clearly known. I mentioned it already. So, but still you get microcytic anemia and copper deficiency. That's true fact. And whenever the hemoglobin is reduced, you're going to get a microcytic anemia. I told this fact already. So it could be due to either defective heme synthesis or it could be due to defective globin synthesis. Defective globin synthesis is what we refer to as something called a thalassemia. So defective heme synthesis can be coming from many areas. For example, it could be due to defective iron synthesis. So this is what we refer to as iron deficiency anemia. So whenever iron supply is reduced, you're going to get defective heme production, and that's what we call iron deficiency anemia. Clear? So similarly, I told you defective protoporphyrin synthesis can also result in a microcytic anemia. So defective protoporphyrin synthesis usually happens in sideroblastic anemias. Defective protoporphyrin synthesis happens in sideroblastic anemias. So what's happening here? Really, you can see, again I'll write the same. You have heme synthesis, and you have globin. Both these things should form hemoglobin, and I told you it comes from protoporphyrin and it comes from iron over here. So whenever protoporphyrin is defective, I told you this is what is going to result in a sideroblastic anemia. So why I am trying to tell this again and again? Because whenever there is a defective protoporphyrin synthesis, heme production will reduce. Even though globin is normal, that is the reason why hemoglobin is reduced, and that is the reason why you are going to get a microcytic anemia. But you can see here, in a true protoporphyrin synthesis defect, your iron is okay. There is no problem in the iron actually, which means the iron cannot be utilized to produce heme synthesis. Because the problem is not the iron here, iron is okay. It's only the problem is the protoporphyrin. So iron is okay. So which means in this condition, in a sideroblastic anemia, there will be underutilization of iron. There will be underutilization of iron. Because of the underutilization of the iron, sideroblastic anemia patients may show features of iron overload. Sideroblastic anemia patients may show features of iron overload. Remember, this iron overload can happen. You can ask me, sir, then in porphyrin synthesis defects also, you can get iron overload. Yes. But in porphyrin synthesis defects, it depends on where iron overload can be exclusively seen in the liver or can be seen in the bone marrow or can be seen in both bone marrow and liver. So it depends. So first you have to understand a sideroblastic anemia or a defective porphyrin synthesis, you're going to have a iron overload. So that's a basic thing to understand, because when you want to differentiate a microcytic anemia, this point is really important to know. So this is how you classify a anemia, so microcytic anemia. So now I can tell defective heme synthesis can happen with iron deficiency anemia and sideroblastic anemia, and defective globin is what we refer to as a thalassemia. Clear? So basically these are the major differential diagnosis that you're going to look for. All right. Clear. So now let us see some of the causes and classification of a normocytic anemia. So what are going to be the causes of a macrocytic anemia? Where is that? I want a little bit slower, smaller one. Okay. We'll go to the pen. Macrocytic anemia. Clear? Sorry, normocytic anemia. So in normocytic anemia, how can you classify? Normocytic anemia is classified actually based on the reticulocyte index. I'll tell you in a different video what you mean by reticulocyte index. I mean, sideroblastic anemia you're calling as dimorphic, not really dimorphic. They are actually coming under microcytic anemia only. Your macrocytic anemia, certain macrocytic anemia may be dimorphic, which can be normo or macrocytic. But generally, sideroblastic anemia, I don't think any book will give a dimorphic anemia. When you call a dimorphic, it should have a mixed microcytic macrocytic picture. So I don't think sideroblastic anemia is going to have a mixed microcytic macrocytic picture unless until they have a bone marrow failure. So maybe they have a bone marrow failure, they might have a dimorphic picture. Other, apart from that, I don't think they're going to have a dimorphic picture. At least for exam sake, don't tell sideroblastic anemia is going to have macrocytic picture. I mean, classically, any examiner, it's a time-tested thing. They're going to expect sideroblastic anemia is going to be microcytic only. So that's what my final verdict will be. Okay, anyway, so you have reticulocyte index. Based on the reticulocyte index, you can tell. Based on reticulocyte index, you can tell either it's a hypoproliferative anemia or it could be a hyperproliferative anemia. So when you call a hyperproliferative anemia, especially when the reticulocyte index is going to be less than 2. Hyperproliferative anemia, whenever the reticulocyte index will be more than 2. Whenever the anemia is normocytic, before even seeing the reticulocyte index, you have to see, is there any ongoing blood loss? Because ongoing blood loss is a different entity. Suppose if you know some patients are having ongoing blood loss, that indicates a hemorrhage. That's a separate cause. It will not, I mean, there is no point in seeing reticulocyte index there because ongoing blood loss is a completely different entity. Clear? So there also reticulocyte index will be more than 2 only. But basically what I'm trying to tell is something different. So rule out ongoing hemorrhage whenever you see a normocytic anemia. That's very important. So whenever you are seeing a hypoproliferative anemia, you can tell this anemia is likely to be non-hemolytic. In a pure non-hemolytic anemia, it tends to be hyperproliferative. In a hemolytic anemia, it tends to be hyperproliferative. Remember, even in ongoing blood loss, reticulocyte index tends to be more than 2. So, but leave that. I'm not going to come about that. So let us see reticulocyte index more than 2 versus reticulocyte index less than 2. So what are the conditions that produces non-hemolytic? So any condition that produces bone marrow failure. For example, if you have an aplastic anemia, if you're going to have an aplastic anemia, or if you're going to have a iron deficiency anemia. Sorry, iron deficiency anemia, you will not put under bone marrow failure. Let us sell something called a pure red cell aplasia. Pure red cell aplasia and many other failure conditions are there which can produce this hyperproliferative type. Then iron deficiency anemia can write separately. Definitely it's a hyperproliferative anemia only, because to produce good number of RBCs, to produce good maturation of the RBCs, you need iron properly. So that's why in whenever you take a bone marrow, whenever you take a bone and in the bone marrow, you know the process happening. Initially it will be colony forming unit erythroblast. So this CFU will become pro-erythroblast, and through subsequent multiple process, they are going to become reticulocyte. And once this reticulocyte reaches the blood, they form mature RBCs in the blood, right? So for this process, you need a lot of things to happen. For example, the survival of the colony forming unit typically depends on erythropoietin. Erythropoietin maximally stimulates the survival of the colony forming unit of the erythroblast, of the erythrocyte. So for pro-erythrocyte, you need still erythropoietin is needed, but very little, like very little, it's not that much. The main area where erythropoietin exerts its action is on the colony forming unit erythroblast only. For survival of CFUE, erythropoietin is mandatory. Without this, CFUE is not going to survive at any cost. So the basic survival of colony forming unit erythroblast depends on your erythropoietin only. So now you have a pro-erythroblast. So remember, for pro-erythroblast to mature, forward, you need certain maturation substances. Like for example, you need iron, you need B12, you need folic acid. All these things are important to cause sufficient maturation and for this process to happen from pro-erythroblast to reticulocyte and to mature RBC formation, you need good supply of iron, B12 and folic acid. Suppose if some of these substances are not available properly, your pro-erythroblast or majority of the steps in between after pro-erythroblast, you have the normoblast stage. Normoblast itself, we have early, intermediate, late normoblast, which finally then becomes reticulocyte. So there will be a block in the maturation process. You will not get proper maturation, which means they will have a low reticulocyte production only and they will have a low amount of mature RBCs in the peripheral smear only. That is why iron deficiency anemia, whenever you have a B12 deficiency, anyway, B12 deficiency will not come under your, normocytic anemia. But why I told you is because iron deficiency anemia will come under hypoproliferative anemias only. Clear? It's a very important example of hypoproliferative anemia. Even B12 and folic acid deficiency causing megaloblastic anemia also will come under hypoproliferative anemias, but this will not come under microcytic anemia because they are going to produce macrocytic anemias. That's it. So that is the basic. That's why I'm writing only iron deficiency anemia in this particular column. And apart from that, early stages of anemia of chronic disease will have normocytic picture only, normocytic anemias only. But late stages of anemia of chronic disease in late stages will have microcytic picture only. That's why I didn't write in the beginning, because otherwise you will be confused. What happens in anemia of chronic disease and why you will get microcytic picture? Again, I told you iron is a very important compound for producing heme that has to mix with globin and this has to produce hemoglobin, right? So I told you if reduced iron available, because of diet or some nutritional defect, if iron is low, that is what we refer to as iron deficiency anemia. Suppose if iron cannot be utilized, if there is poor utilization of iron, if iron cannot be utilized at all, iron is available, all right, available in the body, but it cannot be utilized, poor utilization of the iron because of the block in the utilization of the iron. So usually block in the utilization happens due to excessive cytokines, and this excessive cytokines will result in excessive hepcidin, and this excessive hepcidin is going to cause a block in the iron utilization or iron release into the serum. Because of that, if you have low hemoglobin and because of that you have microcytic anemia. So this is what we refer to as, because this increased cytokines is due to inflammation, and typically if it's due to chronic inflammation, we are going to call it as anemia of chronic disease. So that is the basic idea of anemia of chronic disease. What is the name of the cell that forms colony forming unit in erythrocyte formation? That is blast forming unit. So before CFU, you have a blast forming unit BFU. Before BFU, you have a common myeloid progenitor, and before the common myeloid progenitor, you are going to have a hematopoietic stem cell. So that's a pluripotent hematopoietic stem cell. So that is not the idea of discussion right now, but anyway, I told you. So there's no specific name for that. That's simply we are going to call it as a colony forming unit erythrocyte. So that is what is going to give rise to the pro-erythroblast. Anyway, so this is the mechanism of why anemia of chronic disease is going to produce microcytic anemia as well. That is because of the poor iron utilization, not because of the poor iron availability. Poor iron availability is different. So, that is iron deficiency anemia. Iron is there in the body, but it cannot be utilized. So that's what we call it as a anemia of chronic disease. Clear? So in early stages, anemia of chronic disease is supposed to be normocytic only, but in late stages only, they tend to be microcytic. Typically in a hemolytic anemia, so what are the conditions that produce hemolytic anemia? A lot of conditions can produce hemolytic anemia. Many hemoglobinopathies will produce normocytic anemia only. Exception, thalassemia, very important exception. But the most important example is sickle cell disease, because many students think sickle cell is microcytic. I don't know why they ask this question, but sickle cell disease is a typical example of a normocytic anemia only, but only the shape of the RBC is different here. That's all, nothing to worry about that. And a lot of enzyme deficiencies, apart from hemoglobinopathies, you have enzyme deficiencies. A lot of congenital enzyme deficiencies can also result in normocytic hemolytic causes, like you have pyruvate kinase deficiency. PK is pyruvate kinase deficiency, and you have G6PD deficiency. Then phosphofructokinase deficiency, very rare enzyme deficiency. So these are some of the enzymes that can produce normocytic and hemolytic anemia. So then membrane defects. A lot of RBC membrane defects produces hemolytic anemia. Still, it's going to produce microcytic and normocytic anemia only, like sickle cell we wrote already. Hereditary spherocytosis is an example of a membrane defect causing normocytic anemia. And you have autoimmune hemolytic anemias, which is due to autoimmune causes. Autoimmune hemolytic anemia, it could be warm type or cold type. Warm type is mediated by IgG and cold type is mediated by IgM antibodies. So we have a separate discussion we'll do in subsequent lectures on autoimmune hemolytic anemia, but right now let me tell autoimmune anemia. The important feature of this autoimmune hemolytic anemia is very important, because this is the only cause that will have direct Coombs test positivity. Among all the hemolytic causes, this is the usual only cause that produces DCT positive. In all the other conditions, direct Coombs test will be negative only. Clear? Direct Coombs test will be negative. So it's very easy to find out. So autoimmune hemolytic anemia. That's why whenever you suspect a hemolytic anemia, one of the first tests we do is the DCT, because you have to rule out or rule in autoimmune hemolytic anemic causes. That's why. Then you have microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. We had a whole lot of discussion, the same YouTube session. One of my first YouTube sessions is on TMAs, that is called thrombotic microangiopathies, that is going to produce microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. Then you can get in some infections causing hemolysis, like malaria, where still you will get normocytic anemia only, and they are hemolytic causes. Malaria, babesiosis, all these are examples of hemolysis, but normocytic anemia causes. So these are some of the examples of hyperproliferative hemolytic anemias, which have reticulocyte count more than or equal to 2, and they have a normocytic picture, that is MCV of 80 to 100. So this is how you classify, clear? Obviously. So remember, whenever you get a microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, it's a very easy thing to find out, because these patients will have cystocytes in the peripheral smear. Cystocytes are nothing but fragmented RBCs. Whenever you see cystocytes, you can think about microangiopathic hemolytic anemia and TMS. So, whenever infections is causing hemolytic anemia, usually you will have that inclusion bodies. For example, in malaria, babesia, very commonly you will have inclusion bodies in exam. So with this, you can find out infections causing hemolytic anemia. If it's membrane defect causing hemolytic anemia, definitely patients will have abnormal shaped RBCs, like spherocytes, elliptocytes, some abnormal shape of the RBCs will be there. And obviously the examiner will give osmotic fragility test will be positive. So OFT will be positive. And for hereditary spherocytosis alone, you can use a newer test, which is much, much better test. That's called EMA binding assay. That's called eosin 5 malimide assay. So that's called EMA binding. This is the current test of choice for diagnosing hereditary spherocytosis. That's called EMA binding. So eosin 5 malimide. So these are some of the examples. Obviously, this will be presenting something different, pyruvate kinase deficiency and G6PD deficiency. Most of the time, this will be intermittent hemolysis. Most of them, most commonly. I'm not telling, continuous hemolytic picture are also being described. Usually, typically in a G6PD deficiency, you will have intermittent hemolysis, plus there will be some history of drug exposure. History of drug exposure will be there, like fava beans or some primaquine or some other anti-malarial drugs will be there. Obviously, sickle cell disease, you can easily know, peripheral smear will show sickle cells. That's all. So these are some examples I'm telling you. So how to differentiate each and every cause. Some just simple point, because I'm just giving an overall approach, because anemia is not something very simple like what I've told you right now. So many other things are there to understand as well. But this is the easier things to know. So this is how differentiate. So whenever you have MCV of more than 100, so you know it's a macrocytic anemia. So whenever you have a macrocytic anemia, you have to know whether what is the reason for macrocytic anemia. What is going to reason for macrocytic anemia? Whether it's a megaloblastic macrocytic anemia or a non-megaloblastic type of macrocytic anemia. Whether it's a megaloblastic macrocytic anemia or a non-megaloblastic type of macrocytic anemia. So whenever you call a megaloblastic, what do you mean by the term megaloblastic? Megaloblastic means the patient will have impaired DNA synthesis. Impaired DNA synthesis. At the same time, one of the biggest evidences, patient may have hypersegmented neutrophils. Hypersegmented neutrophils. So if you have hypersegmented neutrophils and if you have evidence of impaired DNA synthesis, because this is evidence of impaired DNA synthesis. So if you have that, then you can call it as a... again, iron deficiency anemia. Amitesh, you are telling both micro and normocytic. I don't believe, because iron deficiency anemia, the basic picture itself is microcytic only. Maybe during treatment of iron deficiency anemia, they may get a dimorphic picture like micro and normocytic, but I don't think a pure iron deficiency anemia is going to have a micro and a normocytic picture. I bet you absolutely it's not possible. So maybe you might argue very, very early stages of iron deficiency anemia, but still, you know, like I am absolutely convinced that iron deficiency anemia is going to produce microcytic anemic picture only. And maybe during the treatment of iron deficiency anemia, you might get a combination of micro and normocytic picture. That is because of the proliferation of the RBCs, so that could be seen, but a dimorphic picture, but I don't think that is possible in a pure case of iron deficiency anemia by any means, because that is the way you diagnose an iron deficiency anemia. Alright, so impaired DNA synthesis. So whenever you have an impaired DNA synthesis, this is what we refer to as a hypersegmented, evidence of impaired DNA synthesis, hypersegmented neutrophil. So a lot of conditions, typical examples. It could be vitamin B12 deficiency can produce megaloblastic anemia. Folate deficiency can produce a megaloblastic anemia. Then a myelodysplastic syndrome, very important. Myelodysplastic syndrome will have megaloblastic anemia. So how will you differentiate between these causes and myelodysplastic syndrome? Obviously, clinical profile is very important. In myelodysplastic syndrome, patient will be very elderly. At the same time, they will have peripheral smear will show dysplastic changes in the blood cells. Dysplastic changes in the blood cells. What are these dysplastic changes? Again, that's a topic of another day. It's a huge topic. Dysplastic blood cells like RBCs, thrombocytes, you can see nuclear changes in the RBCs. You can see some changes like pond ball megakaryocytes are there. So many changes are there in the MDS related dysplastic blood cells. But that presence of dysplastic cells is the biggest evidence that you're dealing with a myelodysplastic syndrome related macrocytosis. And next, it could be due to drug-induced macrocytosis. Drug-induced macrocytosis. What are the drugs that cause macrocytosis itself is a huge area. So I'll tell you one by one. Then it could be due to Fanconi anemia. Fanconi anemia can produce megaloblastic changes. Then you have orotic aciduria. These are very rare causes. Orotic aciduria can produce megaloblastic changes, and at the same time you have a disease called TRMA. So this is called a time in responsive megaloblastic anemia. So this is again a very rare entity and a congenital entity. It is due to deficiency of a protein called SLC19A2. So this is a thiamine transporter. This SLC19A2 is actually a thiamine transporter. So if the mutations are there in a thiamine transporter, you can get this kind of megaloblastic anemia that is called TRMA, thiamine responsive megaloblastic anemia. These patients present with anemia, is have a triad actually. So they come with a triad, they come with anemia, diabetes, and you have sensory neural hearing loss. So this is the triad of TRMA. So this is how they present usually. So might be a question exam, probably a question exam, we don't know, but I mean, if you want to screw you up, they might ask you these kind of questions. So this is a very rare entity. So, but obviously what you're going to see is the first three only. These are the three conditions that produces megaloblastic changes. First three, vitamin B12 deficiency, folate deficiency, and myelodysplastic syndrome. Probably drug-induced, I will tell separately in some time. So non-megaloblastic, a lot of causes are there. Here, the idea is they are normal DNA synthesis and they will not have hypersegmented neutrophils. Not possible. They may not have hypersegmented neutrophils. So this is what we called as non-megaloblastic, which means they have a normal DNA maturation. Normal DNA maturation, but in this condition, megaloblastic, there is impaired DNA maturation. That's the reason. Impaired DNA synthesis as well as impaired DNA maturation. Clear. So what are the conditions that produces non-megaloblastic? First, always is alcohol, most common cause. Whenever they ask you non-megaloblastic macrocytosis, first you have to think about alcohol. Alcohol is one of the very important conditions that produce non-megaloblastic macrocytosis. You know, how will you diagnose chronic alcoholism? Previously, when we used to, you know, like sit in the casualty, I mean, I'm telling you, in the late 2010s, during that time, I'm not telling the last one decade. Before the last one decade, when I used to sit in the casualty during those times, police used to come. Police used to bring the drunken drive cases. The drunken drive cases, how they identify is actually by seeing the peripheral smear macrocytosis. One evidence for that the patient is a drunkard. You know, like this is absolutely nonsensical because I don't think macrocytosis is an example of a chronic alcoholism. It doesn't mean that the patient has taken alcohol yesterday or today. Then came the later GGT testing. So usually in the 2011s, 2010s and all, you know, like they become a little bit advanced. They check for GGT because GGT is a test of alcohol abuse. And again, this is not so correct because it doesn't really imply yesterday or current alcohol abuse. It might be a previous alcohol abuse. So in the drunken drive case, it's not relevant. So that is why currently we are using the blow test. You're blowing, isn't it, in the straw, which directly measures the alcohol content, the alcohol breath. So that's what we are using right now. So this is what the police uses right now. But this is the evolution. But anyway, alcohol, why I told you this is because alcohol is a very important cause of macrocytosis, chronic alcoholism, and is the most common cause in the community. And you have liver disease, fair enough, they can cause macrocytosis. Then you have a condition like diamond black fan anemia. So it's called diamond black fan syndrome, congenital syndrome, diamond black fan anemia. Then you have hypothyroidism. Hypothyroidism is a very important cause of macrocytosis. Then you have scurvy, vitamin C deficiency, benign non-megaloblastic macrocytosis. Then you have multiple myeloma, can produce macrocytosis. These are rare causes. These are not common causes. Then after splenectomy, post-splenectomy can produce macrocytosis. Very rare cause, again not common. And bariatric surgeries can produce macrocytosis. Reason why, we don't know, but again, bariatric surgery is an important cause of macrocytosis. And finally, you have Down syndrome, which can produce macrocytosis. Again, reason, we don't know. So, Down syndrome. So, all these conditions can produce non-megaloblastic macrocytosis. Clear? But in particular, I told you certain causes like bone marrow failure syndromes here. You can see I told you certain causes of bone marrow failure here. So, these bone marrow failure causes can produce normocytic as well as macrocytic anemia. So you don't get confused when the textbooks tells whether it's normo or macro. So they can produce both normocytic as well as macrocytic picture. Clear? And similarly, myelodysplastic syndrome is again very notorious, which can result in both normocytic as well as macrocytic picture. So these are some of the variations, but these are really, really important. So you have to know which produces megaloblastic anemia and which produces non-megaloblastic macrocytosis. But I have not explained this drugs. Drugs are a huge part, isn't it? Drug-induced macrocytosis, megaloblastic anemia. So what are the drugs that produces megaloblastic changes? So drugs that produce megaloblastic changes, you can classify under two. Those induces megaloblastic changes directly. Or those that induce megaloblastic changes by interfering with B12 or folate metabolism. So there are two groups of drugs you can differentiate. So what are the drugs that induces megaloblastic changes directly? Like azathioprine, you know, it's a problem, you know, like it's a purine analog. It's going to cause problem in the DNA synthesis directly. And cladribine, a lot of anti-cancer drugs will come under this area only. Then you have 5-fluorouracil, 6-mercaptopurine. I should have written here actually, along with azathioprine. But anyways, so don't mind. So you have hydroxyurea, very important drug. Then among all the drugs, this is the most important for exam. Certain NRTAs in HIV patients, especially when you're using this NRTA, the most important is the azithromycin and lamivudine, 3TC. 3TC is nothing but lamivudine. So azithromycin and lamivudine, very, very important, because if you ask this azithromycin, especially we consider as a marker of complaints. Currently, we don't use much of azithromycin in HIV patients because we have very modern regimens which use tenofovir, emtricitabine, and currently we go towards the integrase inhibitors like raltegravir and dolutegravir. But azithromycin is often considered as a very good marker of this macrocytosis in patients taking azithromycin, that AZT, zidovudine, is a marker of complaints in this patient. Suppose if the patient doesn't have macrocytosis after taking the zidovudine, you might even tell that the patient is not complaint. It's a very important point, because during those days where we use azithromycin very commonly, zidovudine commonly, they used to see the peripheral smear and look for macrocytosis to ensure the complaints of the patient, that the patient is taking this drug. So that's why this could be a very important question for the exam. All right. So you have NRTAs, then especially the zidovudine, then N2O can induce megaloblastic changes directly. Very important point. You have to know nitrous oxide. You know that this is a very important exam point. Again, patient who's inhaling nitrous oxide for a quite long time, they might result in megaloblastic anemia. Then trimethoprim, because they interfere with not with the folate metabolism, they cause folate synthase deficiency. That's why. Then methotrexate, mycophenolate, MMF, mycophenolate, mofetil, then allopurinol, then pentostatin, a lot of drugs are there, but I'm only telling a handful of drugs. These are the drugs that can directly induce megaloblastic changes. Among all this, the most important is going to be the zidovudine, nitrous oxide, probably trimethoprim and methotrexate. So these are the four drugs at least you have to know for the exams. Maybe hydroxyurea, five drugs. So remember this, five drugs for exams. Very, very important. So seeing the exams for a very long time, I know these are going to be the most important, obviously. And those interfere with B12 and folate metabolism. Two drugs are very important for exams. One is phenytoin and second one is metformin. That's it. So these are multiple times asked question. Whenever you think of a NEET PG exam, these two drugs, they have asked multiple times. If you go and see phenytoin side effects, they will give B12 deficiency and megaloblastic anemia as one of the very characteristic side effect. And metformin, in the long run, you can get B12 deficiency and megaloblastic anemia. Multiple times asked question again. Then you can get with colostramine. These are not that important, but still, let me tell you. Colostramine, then certain antibiotics itself can induce B12 and folate deficiency. Like, these are very rare cause. Again, erythromycin, if you take for a long time, ampicillin, if you take for a long time, then chloramphenicol, if you take for a long time again, then tetracyclines, if you take for a long time, and finally, nitrofurantoin. I think that's enough. So these are the drugs that can cause B12 and folate deficiency. Interfere with the B12 and folate absorption. Interfere with the B12 and folate absorption, and because of that, you can result in megaloblastic anemia. So phenytoin reduces B12 absorption, and metformin also reduces B12 absorption in the long run. So that is the reason why they develop this kind of megaloblastic anemias. So I think we have covered a decent approach on anemia. So let me recap what we have studied. Whenever you see an anemia, see the MCV. See the MCV. If MCV is less than 80, think about microcytic anemia. If the MCV is 80 to 100, think of normocytic anemia. If the MCV is more than 100, think about macrocytic anemia. So whenever normocytic anemia is there, your reticulocyte index is less than or more than or equal to 2. If it's less than 2 or more than 2, less than 2, think about non-hemolytic causes more than to think about hemolytic causes versus a ongoing blood loss, right? Versus an ongoing blood loss. So if you have microcytic, you have to see the iron indices. That's very important, pretty important. You have to look at the iron indices. You have to see if the iron indices are low. If the iron indices are low, which means iron storage is low. For example, ferritin is low. Or if the iron indices are normal, that ferritin is normal. If iron indices are high, that is ferritin levels are high. That's what I'm going to see. If ferritin is low, I can tell it's likely to be an iron deficiency anemia, or probably you are dealing with a thalassemia. Yeah. So, iron deficiency anemia. So, if the normal ferritin, you are going to deal with a thalassemia minor or a trait. But remember, the actual indices of thalassemia major is quite different. That's what I'm going to tell. So, if ferritin is high, it usually goes towards a sideroblastic anemia, or probably you are dealing with a anemia of chronic disease, or probably you are dealing with a thalassemia major. Thalassemia major, why the ferritin levels are high in thalassemia major? That is because thalassemia major patients tends to be transfusion dependent. So because they are transfusion dependent, because they are going to receive multiple transfusions, so this is very important, because thalassemia major, the most important thing that will tell you it's a thalassemia major is the transfusion dependency, which means they cannot survive without this transfusion. So that's the idea. So sideroblastic anemia will have a whole lot of different picture, and anemia of Crohn's disease is going to have again a different picture. So we know that how we are to diagnose these conditions. And finally, you have macrocytic picture. Look for the hypersegmented neutrophils and DNA, and the nuclear changes. So based on that, if it is there, it's likely to be megaloblastic. If there megaloblastic, then if it is not there, it is non-megaloblastic. In the megaloblastic, look for history of drug intake, or if the patient is having some dysplastic changes. Any dysplastic changes are there? If no, then likely to be pure B12 or folate nutritional deficiency. If it's there, then think about drug induced megaloblastic anemia, or it could be myelodysplastic syndrome. I told you myelodysplastic syndrome typically diagnosed in elderly with dysplastic changes. Drug induced patients will not have any, usually no dysplasia, no dysplastic changes. So if we have dysplastic changes, it goes towards MDS. Non-megaloblastic is very easy. Most common cause will be alcohol. Alcohol is going to be the most common cause. So this is how you're going to some simple approach in anemia. Inside each and everything, you have multiple different approaches. So I'm not going to discuss in this particular video because I have some time constraint also. But apart from that, I think, hope this approach would have helped you to an extent how to differentiate each and every different types of anemias. So with this, I think we can close the session. If you have any doubt, you can ask. I'll give you 2 minutes. Okay, so if you don't have any doubts, I think I can close the session. And with this, thank you very much for joining with me. And this is not the only end, because anemia is such a huge, huge and huge topic. This is just orientation and approach to anemia. So with this, I'll sign off, and we can see in the next video. Maybe tomorrow, I think I've planned another session. Thank you very much. Thank you all.